Beginning the current daf, Masech is bed daf chazayin. Begin 6 lines daf the tab of the yam. We the Gemara continues regarding the halacha of the machlekes in our Mishnah regarding the halacha of checking the mumen of the bechor on yamtiv that's permitted or not, and what is the actual halachic practice. Shish kohen's pasuk bekazik and the cheskel to enter daf. Chaim Bishop is joining us today's daf. Some things we discuss in today's daf are: when is a mumcha permitted to rule on a mum of a bechor on yamtiv, as we discussed in the previous daf. Laws relating to, and the next Mishnah continues regarding laws relating to an animal that dies on Yom Tov. How to purchase an animal on Yom Tov without transgressing the laws of Mekach Memcha, because obviously you're not supposed to do business. How can you actually purchase an animal on Yom Tov itself? So Mekitim is constantly discussing today's step, our Bechor, which that's what we're discussing regarding the firstborn of the ox, the sheep, and the goat, which has sanctity as a carbon automatically from birth. Muktzah is that which is set aside, meaning not prepared, but actually set aside on the side, which one is not allowed to use on Shabbos Yom Tov. Challah is the one of the 24 matnas kuna that you have to separate from the dough when you're making bread. Mekach Memcha b'Shabbos Yom Tov is the prohibition of doing business dealings on Shabbos and Yom Tov. So we begin the current daf of Chav Zayin Med Aleph. Continue on this theme regarding checking a mum of a bechor on Yom Tov. So the Gemara brings that Rabbi Yehuda Nesiyah. He was not Rabbi Yehuda Nasi, he was a grandson. So he had a firstborn animal, which as Rashi points out, it's actually someone just asked me a moment ago, that the Matnas Kohuna of Bechor, that's the one of the 24 gifts he gave to Kahanim. So it wasn't that he was a Kohen, but in his own house he had Kahanim that ate at his table, and they would eat the Bechoris. So although he himself wasn't a Kohen, he still had the firstborn animals. And Shalom came into Rabbi Ami, he sent a friend of Rabbi Ami on Yom Tov to see, okay, make min shechten, you're allowed to shecht it, is it a, because it has to have a mum. So Rabbi Ami thought that he's not going to go and look at this animal on Yom Tov to see if it has a blemish, which is like Rabbi Shimon of our Mishnah, which we had mentioned that he holds that the ingrowing mum and claw. So I'm like, Rabbi Zreka beat him, sometimes it was Rabbi Yirmi who said to him, why? Rabbi Yehuda, but Rabbi Shimon, when we have a machlekes, Rabbi Shimon, which was in our Mishnah, the machlekes, halacha, Rabbi Yehuda, as the Gemara says in Eivin, there's a certain klolim and shas, and one of them is that when you're machlekes, Rabbi Shimon, it looks like Rabbi Yehuda. Rabbi Yehuda says, you're allowed to be right, moment, be yomtiv. Why not checking out the blemishes to see if it's blemished? So, how does Shadrila come in Rabbi Yitzchak Nafa? So, then Rabbi Yehuda, see, he went and he sent it in front of Rabbi Yitzchak Nafa. He also, the next Rav, thought he's not going to go out and look at it. And he's not going to check it out to see if it has a blemish. So Rabbi Yirmiya, and again, beat him in some of the Rabbi Zreika, that Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Shimon, halach Rabbi Yehuda. Why? Why wouldn't you check out the blemishes? We know when these two great Torah giants disagree, halach Rabbi Yehuda, and Rabbi Yehuda says you could check out blemishes on Yom Tov. So Rabbi Baba said to whether it be Rabbi Yirmiya or Rabbi Zreika, he says, what's that? It's my time, Aleishav, Kasinu L'Rabban, and why don't you let the rabbis lemever of the Rabbi Shimon to do like Rabbi Shimon? Why are you telling them to do like Rabbi Yehuda? Samaleis, Rabbi Zeika, said to Rabbi Abba, what do you mean? Va'at ma b'yotcho, and what do you have? Why are you leaving Rabbi Yehuda and you want them to do like Rabbi Shimon? Where would you see the halacha like Rabbi Shimon over here? What do you mean? We always know halacha like Rabbi Yehuda. So that's why I'm asking them. Why are you bothered that I'm bothering them? Then why are they doing like Rabbi Shimon? Samaleis says, I'll tell you why. Because halacha Rabbi Zeira. Rabbi Zeira said halacha like Rabbi Shimon. Halacha like Rabbi Shimon. So you're right, although general halacha is like Rabbi Yehuda, these rabbis, they're all doing like Rabbi Shimon, that you don't look at the mumen b'chlal on Yom Tov, because that's what Rabbi Zeira said. So Amar Mandehu, this is like one of the students, like it says, whoever he was, no one knew his name, but Mandehu, whoever he was, so one of the students spoke up, he says, wow, eski, let it be the will of Hashem that I can marry v'esik l'hasam. I go up to Eretz Yisrael, to where Rabbi Zeira lived, who he's the one who taught this teaching, that in his name everyone's saying halacha is like Rabbi Shimon. And I could go ahead and learn this teaching from the mouth of the master himself, meaning everyone's saying it over there. Let me go up and see what he actually said. When he finally made up to Eretz Yisrael, he encountered Reb Zera. So he said to him, did the master say halacha is like Reb Shimon? That everyone's quoting you and saying that, the halacha is going to be that you don't look at moving at all? Amalei says, no. You know what I said? Ano mi mistabra. That's logical, like Rabbi Shimon. That I said, but I never heard that they had made permanent halacha lemaisa was like Rabbi Shimon. All I was saying that I could hear ken heren as the zolzayin. You know why? Because Megtan, when we learned in the Mishnah, we said we quoted Rabbi Shimon. What was Rabbi Shimon's statement? Shimon Naimi says, he said that if the blemish is not recognizable from before Yom Tov, so he said, Ein zeh min ha-muchen. He says, that's not considered that it's prepared. Now, the Ketani Lo Bebraisa, we actually quoted this in the previous stuff. In a Braisa, it was quoted B'loshen Chachamim. The Braisa was on Chavav and Mebeis, on the previous stuff. It said that he came and he brought a Braisa in his hands, and his words were, whether it developed a blemish from before Yom Tov, whether it developed a blemish on Yom Tov, that the Chachamim say, etc. We had quoted an opinion, which is really, the Gemara pointed out, there must be Reb Shimon. And we had, it was part of a deep, we wanted to say, with the three different levels, the tiers of when it's but be that as it may, that was Reb Shimon, that you cannot look at a blemish on Yom Tov. And you know what they're called? He's called over the Chachamim. It's called the Chacham. Chacham is generally the Rav. Shema Minam, Mustabu Kabba says. Reb Zeir said, I never said that Halacha is like him. I never heard that Messiah. All I said, it was logical to say that Halacha is like him because he's quoting a Braisa, not as his own opinion, but as the Chachamim. And when you say the Chacham, that generally means that that's who it is. So says the Gemara, okay, but Mahavala, so what actually is the conclusion? It means that there's no definitive ruling like Reb Shimon. So what is the conclusion? So Reb Yisrael says, I'll tell you. Toshima, come in here. The Talya Ba'ashli Rav Revi, that he's hanging from great and thick ropes that are hard to detach. In other words, there's great sages that said this halacha, that it's also to look at Mumin on Yom Tov like Reb Shimon, and it's not so easy to nullify their words. So this that he had asked all the Rabbanim, and they said, yes, you're not allowed to, even though generally Reb Shimon Yehuda, halacha is like Yehuda, and even Reb Zeir himself, who he's the one officially that said that halacha is like Reb Shimon, he himself said, I didn't say that, all I said was Mustaba, because that's Chacham. But Reb Yisrael says, no, I'll prove to you that the halacha is like Reb Shimon over here. You know why? Because not only Reb Shimon, which this is going to be contested what Reb Yisrael is saying, but this is Reb Yisrael saying. He says, the Reb Shimon ben Pazri, Reb Shimon Levi, Reb Yisrael ben Shul, Levi, a whole long of Messiah over here, and him in the name of him. Bishop Gal, Kaddish, the Bishlam, in the name of the Holy Assembly, the Holy Community of Yerushalayim, that Reb Shimon is actually referring to not Reb Shimon Yechayiv on Mishnah, referring to Reb Shimon ben Manasseh, like Rashi means in this Divrei Maskil, the Chaveirov and his colleagues, meaning regarding those of them that he said on the previous stuff, that ain roin mumen be Yom Tov, that you don't see a mumen on Yom Tov, amru halacha ki Reb Meir. They were saying halacha is like Reb Meir in regards to the laws of in Mishnah in Becheres, which actually, as Rashi just points out, right now it sounds like that the Kahal Kadisha, the holy community of Yerushalayim, was testifying on Reb Shimon ben Manasseh that he also had said this, which Reb Yisus says, Amru? Did they really say this, that Reb Shimon said, Halach is a Reb Meir? But how is it possible that the Kahal Kaddish of Yerushalayim would say something regarding Reb Shimon ben Manasseh and his colleagues that they said Halach is a Reb Meir and were doing like them, but Va'inu Kashisha Minat Tuvu? The Kahal Kaddisha, which was a certain name of a certain time in Yerushalayim, that Rebbe was, if you look at the whole transmission, it's Reb Shimon ben Pazi, a name of Shimon Levi, a name of Reb Yisrael Shal, a name of Rebbe, and the name of the Kahal Kaddisha of Yerushalayim. So Rebbe was saying the name of Kahal Kaddisha. They were older than Reb Shimon ben Manasseh a lot, because Reb Shimon ben Manasseh was in the days of Rebbe and his sons. We find this actually in Mishnah Masechtas Avos in the sixth parak. Reb Shimon Hasi says, these seven midas the Chacham said regarding the Talmidim are all by Rebbe and his sons. And also we had in the previous staff that we had a machlekes between Rebbe and Reb Shimon ben Manasseh. That's actually Reb Shimon that we're quoting from the previous staff, that he was actually supporting the opinion of Reb Shimon, not like Reb Yehuda, not like Rebbe who was going like Reb Yehuda. And so how could the Kahal Kaddisha say halacha as the name of Reb Shimon ben Manasseh, like we're saying that Reb Shimon the Chaveirov said halacha like Reb Meir, if they're older than, if Rebbe, who's basically a little bit older than Reb Shimon ben Manasseh, and Rebbe saying the name of Kahal Kaddisha, they're older than him, so how could Kahal Kaddisha be saying the name of Reb Shimon ben Manasseh, who's obviously younger? So El Rebbe says the Gemara, no. What the Kahal Kaddisha said was what Reb Shimon ben Manasseh and his colleagues, that they say that you don't look at Mumin on Yom Tov, they are Beshitas Remeir Amrua. They said it in the name of Remeir. Meaning, like Rashi says, that's feasible that the elders, that they could give their consent regarding the Bachrim, regarding the younger scholars. And they could say, oh, this that those younger Talmid Chacham are saying, that's okay. We could hear what they're saying because they're going like Reb Meir. So it wasn't that they were saying in the name of Reb Shimon, and because the Kal Kadisha is older than Reb Shimon, not saying in his name. They're just saying what Reb Shimon ben Menasya is saying, that you don't look at Mumin on Yom Tov, him and his Chaverim. That's okay. We could hear their psak, the elder Rabunim said, because they're going like Reb Meir. What's this Reb Meir? That now the Gelun Mishnah sect is Bechayrus. Mishnah says, Hashechet es ha-bachar. Someone slaughters a firstborn animal before the chacham was matred. Meaning you have to go to the chacham and say, does it have a mum? Because if it's not a mum, he's shechting kach and bachutz. Let's say someone shechts the firstborn animal before the chacham permitted. Va'achkav keres mumay. And only subsequently did he show, after he shechted the animal, he comes to the chacham and goes, oh, you see here on the foot over here? See this? Is this a mum? And then it turns out it's a mum, but he shechted beforehand. So Rabbi Yehuda Mater, he says, okay, it's okay. Lamai said, retroactively, we know it had a mum. For Meir, he says, no. Since when you shechted, you did it without the permission, without the validation of the professional, usser, that's it. This animal's usser, you can't eat this bechor. Oh, says Rabbi Yosef like this, and this is what the Kahal Kadisha were saying, that they were validating the opinion of Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya to say that the like Rabbi Shimon, you now look at Mumin B'yamtiv. Why? Where's the longest? So you have to chap the cheshbon Rabbi Yosef, he's teaching up the machlekes, and then you'll see how he's deriving that Reb Meir is like Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya, like Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai of our Mishnah, because like this says Rabbi Yosef, Alma. So you see, Ksav Reb Meir. What does Reb Meir obviously hold? Rias Bechayr, looking at the firstborn animal, is lav is not lenient. Kriyas trefa, like looking at a trefa animal, because the Rabbanan considered significant that the whole permissibility, the whole heter of a bechayr, because again bechayr is a kachim, is a carbon, you're not allowed to go ahead and shecht it and eat it out of the base of mikdash. It's only dependent that when you see it by the chacham, that's the heter. So even the shechit is going to be forbidden if the chacham didn't see it yet. What does that have to do with the chacham? The chacham is just verifying something. It's not being matred. No. You see from Reb Meir that he says, if the chacham didn't look at it before the shechit, taif, throw it out. Why? What do you mean? It turns out it was good. No. The heter is only if he saw it and was matred, which this is not comparable, let's say, to looking at a trefa. Let's say a trefa animal is an animal mortal defect. I'm not sure, it had something. And a regular animal, a whole animal, you shaft it. And the chacham comes over and says, Chabashayla, come here. See the lungs over here? Say, oh, it's good. So that's going to be okay. Because looking at the Bukhari is not Kiri'i's trefa. That's what you see from Reb Meir. Because a trefa, it's okay. If you shaft it and we check it afterwards, you see it's not a moral defect, so good. So it's a kusha. What do you want? But the Bukhari, no. Meir says, The chacham being matrit is integral, it's intrinsic to the heter. Oh, so as Rav Yisrael explained, Riyas Bechor Michayim, looking at the firstborn animal has to be when it's still alive. Riyas Trefa, Lach Hashchita. So looking at the Trefa, the mortal defect could be even after it's slaughtered. Says Rav Yisrael, and this is the point that he's telling in our sugya. Uminah. Ah, it's from view that Rav Shimon ben Menasya and his colleagues were coming and that they were saying, that since the heter of the mum by the chacham is so chashiv, that he's being matrit. Because if it's not, again, it should be just like trefa. After the shechit, it should be okay. No, they're being matrit, so that's like mesakin. Or it's like they're making a din taira, which that you're not allowed to see on Yom Tov. And that even though re'i is trefa filibi Yom Tov, or even though we know the halacha is that you're allowed to look at a trefa, meaning to see if it's a mortal defect or not on Yom Tov, but re'i is bechor has to be me'er of Yom Tov. Lachem Bechor cannot be on Yom Tov, be from before Yom Tov. And that's what was Rav Yisrael was saying, Talia Ba'asher Ravarvi, that they were saying the name of the Kala Kadisha, because Rav Shimon is also going like Reb Meir. So it turns out that Rav Shimon ben Yechoy of our Mishnah and Reb Meir in Bechoyres are really saying the same thing. So it turns out Rabbi Yehuda in our Mishnah, he is the Das Yachid. And we don't go like him, then welcome these two greats of Rav Shimon ben Yechoy and Reb Meir. Because Rabbi Yisrael is learning at the Lomdus of Rabbi Meir is that the heter of the Chacham is what's mesakin it. Varaya is that if you shechted it first, wouldn't be good. So you can't do this on Yom Tov. This is a heter. Treifa, you could look on Yom Tov because looking at it is not really being matrit. If I shechted first, it would be okay also. But Amalei Abaye, Abaye rejects this. Abaye tells Rabbi Yisrael, it's not so pasha what you're saying. He says, Atu Hasam, do you really think over there, that halacha of Remeir regarding the firstborn animal, really think Beroyin Mumin, that is regarding looking at the blemish after the Shechita, that's what Pligi, that's what they're disagreeing about because of this Lomdis that you're saying, or because of a Chashivas that Remeir is saying that the Reina, the Mumin have, that he's being martyred and you shechted beforehand, that means you didn't have the Heter, and if it's like being Masakin something on Yom Tov. No, it's not the Lomdis, it's not the Smara, it's not the logic of that Halacha. Beknasa Pligi. The Machleki says, the Gemara is going to shortly explain, is regarding a penalty. That if a person, and Rashi even points this out, he says, let's say someone else would have shechted it. Because let's say he thought it was permitted by a mumcha. Says Rashi, in explanation of what Abai is saying, of course, even Ramei would agree that you'd be able to look at it, ala acha hamais. Don't give me this lumdis that like, if this should be matrid and you shecht first, no, you can't look at it anymore. It's not true. It's a knas. If someone else would have done it because he thought that it was already checked, and turned out it wasn't, okay, the chacham could look at the bachar after it was done. But because here it's a machlekes regarding a penalty, as the Amar Rav Bechon Amar Rabbi Yechonon, he says, because he qualifies this whole machlekes, he says, Bedukin Sheba'ayin, if let's say this blemish is a cataract in the eye, Kula Amalei Pligi, no one's going to disagree, meaning even Rabbi Huda would agree that the Asr that is going to be forbidden, meaning if you want to check it after the Shechita, Mishum de Mishtan, because it changes after death. As Rashi explains, there's a cataract that could look like, after the Shechita, like a permanent blemish. Where had you seen it before Shechita, you could have been able to discern that it's only a passing blemish, which would not permit it as a Bechor. So no one's going to disagree that really you're not allowed to check it after the Shechita. But that's because a very technical reason, because you won't be able to really discern it after Shechita. Ki Pligi, the whole Machlekes was, as we'll see this right now, is a really a Kenas Machlekes. Is b'mumen shebeguf, is regarding a blemish in the body of the animal. For example, let's say the ear was cut off, or the hand was broken, which that doesn't change because of slaughtering. Really, be'etzim, everyone holds you could check this after the Shechita. The only time they hold that you cannot, where even Rabbi Yehuda would agree, is like something that would change. If it wouldn't change, of course you could check. There's no lumdis of it, so chashim, and it has to be done beforehand. The whole machleki says, Remeir somebody holds, because during the mumen shebeguf, otter mumen shebe'ayin, it's a penalty. We're geizer. We don't let you check by something that doesn't change, like a blemish in the body, because something that would change, let's say like a cataract in the eye. Maybe there's something else like, no, we don't make such a gezeira. But again, so there's no raya to Reb Shimon ben Manasseh from Reb Meir, says Abaye to Reb Yosef, to prove to me that Allah is like Reb Shimon ben Yochayah by Mishnah, not like Reb Yehuda, because they're not even talking about this lumdus that you made up. They're not going with this whole smar that it's so chashim. It's a kanas type of a machlekes, and therefore there's no raya bachlal from this halacha. Now, Amrav Nachman Yitzchak, he actually says masnitin. The Mishnah in Bechayros that we brought is actually nami deke, is actually also precise, like Abaye is refuting Reb Yosef, that because of a gzeiritz asur, and it's a knas, it's a penalty, so that they shouldn't be accustomed to doing this, but nothing to do with your lumdis of because it's so chashim and it has to be done before and because matter. Because Diktani, what's the words of the Mishnah Dei Mecheres? So Remeir, he says, those are Remeir's words. Since it was slaughtered, not through the professional, checking it, it's going to be asr. Shema minah, obviously you see that kanasu with the kukamis, that it's obviously a penalty. Because as Rashi explains, it doesn't say Remeir asr. It should have said, he says it's forbidden. Because that would have sounded like, yeah, it's intrinsically an asr. Because the checking of it after Shechita is ineffective. No. It's not the words he says. He says, because since you violated and you shechted it without the mumcha, obviously, Shema Minah, obviously you see that the reasoning is because you were lenient to shecht it, and Reb Meir makes it dependent on the wickedness of this kohen who he was lenient, and he went and he shechted his bukhar before being checked out. And therefore, again, Abaye stands correct, not like Reb Yosef, and you don't have a definitive proof that the halacha should be like Reb Shimon ben Yochai, Because even Reb Shimon ben Manasseh b'chaveru going like Reb Shimon, it's only Reb Shimon against Reb Yehuda. And generally, you do go like Reb Yehuda. And don't bring me a raya that, oh, I mean, Reb Meir is supporting. Reb Meir has nothing to do with this. Reb Meir is talking about a knas. He's not talking about a lamdis that you see so chashim that it's what's matir, and that's why you can't check it afterwards, and therefore you tell me you can't do it on Yom Tov, because it has nothing to do with that. It's a very different machlekes regarding that of a knas. Now, the Gemara continues on this halacha of our Mishnah. Ami vardina. Either that it was beautiful, and therefore it's called like roses, or he was from a place called Vardina. But be that as I mean, that was his name. Ami Vardina. Chazi Bukhra de Bein Nesiyava. He was the one that would check out the firstborn animals of the household of the Nasi. That a lot of animals, and every firstborn animal had to be checked out to make sure that the blah 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 should be eaten. Now, Yom Tov Alav Chazi. In Yom Tov, he wouldn't check out the blemishes. So, Asav Amalei L'Rabami. They came and told Rabami that the Rav is not checking it. Now, Amalei said to them, Shavakavat L'Chazi. It's very good that he's not looking at them because, again, like we said, this was actually Rabami started off the daf that he didn't want to check it because, like Reb Shimon says, Ein Roim Mumin V'Yom Tov. Says, well, is that really so? But Rabami Gufi Chazi? What do you mean, Rabami himself? He himself would check out the Mumin of Bukhayas on Yom Tov. Says, no, Rabami Kikhazi. Rabami would look at the blemishes on Yom Tov. It's really Me'et Mohav Chazi. The day before, Arab Yom Tov, they would come to him, they would see if it's a permanent blemish or a passing blemish. He would already look at it from before Yom Tov. Now, it's continued to him in days. So what's this on Yom Tov? We knew we saw people coming with the animals to his house. Oh, because the Yom Tov Shiuli Kumishal Hechahava Uvda. On Yom Tov, we would ask him the backstory, how did it happen? Because sometimes every Yom Tov of the Ruv is busy. He has a lot of shy, says, I gotta go right now. Now, but when he saw the blemish, so he would say, please go, come back tomorrow. Then the next day, he would ask him, tell me, how did this blemish happen? Now, why does he have to have a whole story? And the reason is because Kahanama suspect regarding the Bechiris that they would actually intentionally make a blemish. As Mishnah teaches Mechayet of Amayim and Aleph, that all the blemishes that are fit to come through like human intervention, the shepherds are trusted, but the Rahana Kahanim, the Kahanim shepherds, they're not trusted. They have to bring witnesses that happen by itself because the Kahanim are invested. It's their assets, and they have to watch it, and they can only get to use it once it develops a blemish. So he would ask them the whole story. He said, tell me exactly how it happened. So that's what happened to Rabami. Rabami really checked him from before Yom Tov. So, everyone bringing their firstborn animals to Yom Tov, he's just trying to get the full story, the full scoop, to make sure that they didn't make it themselves. As the Gemara brings, Kiha, like we find that Hu Gavra, there was a certain person who was a Kayan, Da'isi Bukhali Kamei de Rav, he brought his firstborn animal from the Rav. And he brought Apani de Mali Yom Tov on Erev Yom Tov. Tabi Yosef Rav, Kachai Fresh, the Ruv is also busy. People think that the Ruv has all the time in the world. He's getting 17 other Shailas, and he doesn't have time for me. And his wife is still telling him that it's Shkia, right? I think I once heard that A.B. Rottenberg's song, it's time to say good Shabbos. I think his wife was telling him that A.B. it's time to get in the shower or something like that. So it's time to say good Shabbos, so take a shower, and he came up with that song then. But he's B'kochai Bresha, and Rava was over there, and he was shampooing his hair. And the other on the door knocking, he wants to know what's going to be with his animal. Could he make the steak on Yom Tov? So Dali Eini, he lifts up his eyes. V'chaz l'muma, he kicked off the mim, he looks at the blemish. Amalei says, okay, Zilod nebetol amacher, go now, come back tomorrow. Pshen gizein. When he came back the next day, Amalei says, hey Chavovde, tell me, what was the story? How did it happen? Amalei, he says, I'll tell you how the blemish happened. Habishad nisar bahach gisa dehutza. There was some barley that was thrown over the side of the fence, and the fence was made out of thorns. Now, by the ihu, the bukhar, the first man animal, was beidach gisa, on the other side of the fence. When they wanted to eat that barley, Ayel Reish stuck in its head, and one of the thorns went and tore its lip. And that's one of the blemishes of Bukhar, if its lip gets burst. And that's recognizable. So he says, Dima ad kiram tale, maybe you caused it. Maybe you intentionally put the barley over there because, again, they're suspect regarding the Bukhar is because it's a big tircha. They have to have all the expenses and to support the animal. And the Yisrael only has to hold on to it for 3 months and then gives it to the Kayim. So maybe you did it. He says, no, I didn't do it. It was just happened to be there and the animal went to get it. And the Gemara explains to him, no, tell me the Grama Asa, why do you even ask it that he caused it? But let's say he caused it. What did he do? He just put the barley over there. Let's say he wanted it. So, but the animal went on its own and cut its lip. How do you know that even a Grama, indirect cause, is forbidden to do that to the Bukhara? So the Gemara, the time I learned the Braisa, says to him, a Yikra, Mumla Yiboy. there shouldn't be any blemish in your karbanos, including the bechor. Now, emi elishlo yahaya baimum. I would only know that you shouldn't cause the blemish, like Rashi says. If it would just say mum, meaning the Rashi in the first, although it says yes, we're pronouncing as lo yahaya. You could read it like you shouldn't cause it to be a blemish. I mean, actually, yigum lo al dei deva achra. How do you know that you shouldn't cause it through an indirect cause? How so? Shlo yovin batze goy devele. You shouldn't bring, let's say, dough or a fig. V'nichle gabi oisin. You'll put on top of the animal's ear. Kedei shiva akel v'yitlen. The dog is going to see it and jump on it, and it's going to grab it away, and it's going to bite its ear. It's going to make a blemish. I mean, you can't even cause it. Tamalavu kamum. It says all blemishes. Where on my mum, it says mum. Vamu kamum. It adds on the word kol. He had it said mum and not kol, so I wouldn't have thought it's going to be aser gram. I would have thought only, you know, I'll make a direct blemish. But now that it already says mum, which is telling you the blemish, and saying kol mum, that kol is coming to kol, even growing, now the cause, and then everybody asked him, maybe you put the barley there. I said, no, I didn't do it. And therefore, it was okay to permit it. But again, he had already looked at it from before Yom Tov, and he was just asking the backstory on Yom Tov itself. So now I love the next Mishnah, which continues on the theme of the previous Mishnah regarding Behemish and Mesa. Which is, we were told about we're afraid if the animal's going to die, and if you wanted to shecht it, and if you have to get some, you have to be able to get it permitted, oichel nefesh. But now here the Mishnah actually talks about behemah shemesah. What happens if an animal dies on Yom Tov? So he's in them coming, I'll move from its place. It's a nevela. It's totally muktzah. Well, ma'isa b'shalosh Reb Tarfon Alev. Actually, there's a story they asked Reb Tarfon regarding such a case. And another question they asked him was about achala shenitmes, regarding chala, which is one of the 24 kana gifts, but it became tummy. So therefore, it's not fit for the kohen today because you can't eat challah tameyah, which is like chuma, that's tameh, which cannot be eaten at all, ever. And additionally, although generally he could take chuma and challah tameh and use it for fuel or give it to his dog, on yom tov not allowed. Why not? Because as halacha, you're not allowed to be mevar, you're not allowed to liquidate kachim that are tameh on yom tov. Even through eating of the animal, and that's what we learn in Sefer Shabbos, you cannot be sorf in kachim yom tov, which is Rashi says not specifically sreifa, because of, let's say, Havara, because you're doing a malacha of burning Shleil Tzarech, because of, you're not allowed to burn Shem and Sreva Yamtiv. So Rashi says no, because that would be considered actually Havara Letzarech, because you're using it to light your lamp on Yamtiv, which is the Tzarech Achilun that's permitted. Even so, this quote unquote Shem and Sreva, you're not allowed to, which that's really Shem and the Truma that became Tameh, that's Exeyas Akasa. You're not allowed to go ahead and take Kachem that became Tameh and liquidate it on Yamtiv, because the Torah considered it for this Havara, like it says, be'esh yisarv, you have to burn the kachim that became tamei. Therefore, it's like a malacha, and again, therefore, you're not liquidated, and even to go ahead and give it to your animal. So, be that made, so what do you do with the challah that became tamei? So, when Nichzal Beis HaMedrash, so Reb Tarfon himself came into the Beis HaMedrash, and he asked, what's the halacha? They said to him, lo yezizim mukayma, both these, the animal that died and the challah that became tamei, they have no yom tov utility whatsoever, and if you're not allowed to move it, it's totally mukta. Now, says the Gemara, lema tanan stama delikim shimon. Let's say our Mishnah is anonymously not like Reb Shimon, which the Tanya, it's a brisa we learn, which is quoted many times in Shas. Reb Shimon, I mean, he says, "Mechatchen es adlun lefnei abehema." He says, you're allowed to cut off the gourds, which is like a type of a pumpkin, type of a vegetable, lefnei abehema, in front of the animal. And as an avail of that club, you could also cut up a dead animal in front of the dogs, which, as Rashi points out, we're talking about it became an avail on Shabbos. From the fact that Reb Yehuda then now disagrees with Reb Yehuda, and he says, no, boy, he's an avail on Erev Shabbos, it was not available before Shabbos. Then Asura, meaning, but if it became an avail from the Shabbos, it would be permitted. Reb Shimon, who is permitting, is even if it became an avail on Shabbos. Yehuda says, no, if it wasn't from before Shabbos, it wasn't prepared, because it was still alive. And Reb Shimon says, no, it's okay even if it became an avail on Yom Tov, on Shabbos. Our Mishnah is not like that. Our Mishnah says that if it became an avail on Yom Tov, you cannot move it. Says the Gemara, no, the Gemara gives two approaches that it could even be like Reb Shimon. I felt like Reb Shimon, you could say Amish like Reb Shimon, because Moed Reb Shimon Bebali Chaim, Reb Shimon agrees by when there was a healthy animal, Bein Lashmash, by twilight, Shemesu, where it ends up dying on Yom Tov, Shasu, and then it would be from it. Because when did Reb Shimon permit an animal that died on Yom Tov? Is when it was in danger of dying already by Bein Lashmash. The guy's like, okay, this one's a goner. This is going to pass out very quickly, and we'll have this animal to feed to the dogs. That's when he permitted. The Gemara says, wait a second. Hanich Lamar Bar Meimer, Mishmei Derava. That's only good according to one opinion, the Amma that says, Moidah Reb Shimon, that he says, yeah, Reb Shimon was agreed that it would be Aser, like Muktzah, but Baal Chaim Shemesu Shasur, and that it was a healthy living animal, but Ben Hashemash, by twilight when Shabbos and Yom Tov started, then Shemesu Betar, Shasur would be forbidden, Shabbat, that would make sense, that our Mishnah could be Yom Tov Shimon. But El Marbarid, Rabbi Yisrael Mishmeid, that his version of Rabbi is that Cholakor, B'Shem Nefil, Babalachem, Shem Neisur, Shem Toron, that no, B'Shem disagreed. No, even a healthy animal, Kiev, it died. B'Shem is the more lenient interpretation of Mokzi. Yeah, it's going to be permitted. So I'm like, what are you going to say? Similarly, our Mishnah, who says that if it dies on Yom Tov, it's not going to be able to be moved, it's not like a B'Shem. So the Gemara, no, a second approach is Tirgim Aziri, Ziri interpreted the Behemoth Kaddishim. We're talking about an animal of Kaddishim, which is forbidden to have benefit, because when the animal dies, it has to be buried and you can't redeem it. And the reason is because you have to do Hamad the Baruch, you have to evaluate it, which has to be done only when it's alive. So therefore, there's no utility of it. You can't feed it to the dogs. Or Rashi says another interpretation, which actually even if you could have pidyon of a kachim, but you can't do pidyon kachim to feed it to the dogs, even according to those who could, you could redeem on Yom Tov, you wouldn't be able to do it with the dogs. And again, therefore it has no utility, and that's why it could be like a Mishnah. And the Gemara actually says, Dekin Nami, like this last answer, actually a precise reading of my Mishnah indicates this, the Ketanik, because our Mishnah said that Aleha, on the Nevela, the dead animal, Valachalash and Nitmes, and regarding the Chavikim Tami, those are the two things they asked from Tarfon, and that they said in the Beis Medrash that Lo Yizid Mekavim, you're not supposed to move them from their place. So it sounds like they're both the same thing, which is, Ma Chala de Kadisha, just like Chala is holy, it's like Truma, Behema de Kadisha, was within the Nevela, which is that of Kachim. So the Gemara says, wait a second. If it's meduig like the second teretz, say Ella, then wait a second. If the Mishnah seems to be indicating that it's similar to challah, then you could infer the other way around. Time of the kadisha sounds like specifically because the animal is kachim, that's why you can't move it. But wait a second. So if you're saying the reason is kachim, so how the chulin shari sounds like actually that if it would be an unconsecrated animal that died, that it would be permitted to give it to the dogs, and it would not be forbidden as mokta. Oh, now it goes the other way around. That he had said that Rabbi Shimon holds that it's mutter even a healthy animal by Minash Mashes, that if it died, be permitted shop, it makes sense. You could say that, yeah, our Mishnah is meduik that a whole animal would be permitted. Who is that? Rabbi Shimon, who doesn't hold a mukta. It's only because it's kachim that it's asa. Because kachim that died, you can't give it to the dog, so it has no utility. But Al-Mabar Amemish Midarabadama, that he said, Rabbi Shimon agrees to make it asa. The Balachayim Shemes regarding it, if it was a healthy animal, in the Shemasha, that if it dies in Yom Tov, it's going to be Aser when it's Chulin. So Michael Nehmer, according to him, our Mishnah is not like a Yehuda and not like a Shimon. Because you're telling me our Mishnah is only by Kachim. It means by Chulin, it would be permitted. Who is that? Not Rabbi Yehuda. Rabbi Yehuda is always Aser. Can't be even Rabbi Shimon, because you tell me Rabbi Shimon agrees that Balachayim Shemes that it is permitted, that it's Aser, but he sees it's permitted. Says Yehuda, no, Hach Meiskin, then he'll tell you what's the case of our Mishnah Tovma, the Musikenis. The reason why it's going to be mutter by chulin is because it was in danger of dying already by Minash Mashas. But Divar Kol never could be like everyone, this is how the Mefresh McLean in Reb Shimon, that it's like Reb Shimon. It's Musikenis. Reb Shimon says it's permitted. And yeah, because he says Mechatna as a luin, and you could cut up the nevela. And that's why it's only because it's kachim you can't move it. But if it was chulin, it would be permitted again because daiti elevei, because it's Musikenis. But if it was healthy, Yitak would hold to be usher even by that of chulin. Now, look at the next Mishnah, continuing on this idea of the animal of meat, and also regarding that relates now to Mekcha Memcha, but it continues on this regarding Basa Behema. Ein Nivna al Behema. You're not allowed to be counted on the animal, which Moses can explain exactly what does this actually mean. L'ketchila b'yamtiv initially on Yamtiv. Avol Nivna l'me erv Yamtiv, but you could go ahead and join together on meat of an animal from before Yamtiv. Or another option you have is v'sheichetin. The butcher could slaughter the animal without making up a price for anyone. And then the people divide amongst themselves. And then tomorrow, after Yom Tov, they'll go ahead and decide how much money was worth the parts that each one got. Now, the Gemara explains my ein nimna. What does this mean that you cannot be counted on the animal initially on Yom Tov? So, maybe the Mishmud says, ein poskin damin. It means you cannot go ahead and set a price, like etchila initially, al behem b'yom tov. And the animal on Yom Tov. The reason for that is because Mekcha Memcha, doing business dealings, it's forbidden on Shabbos and Yom Tov. Like it says in Sefer Nechemya, and therefore you can't go ahead and set prices on Yom Tov. So then the Gemara says, this that the Mishnah said that option number two was that you could just shecht it and just divide it. So Hecha Avit, says the Gemara. How are they going to do this? How are they going to know tomorrow how much was worth the parts that each one ate to evaluate its money? So Rav says, I'll tell you how. He says, maybe you bring for them on Yom Tov, shtei behemas. What you do is, bring two equal type of animals, have them stand near each other, and you say this one's like this one, and tomorrow you'll evaluate the other one, you'll evaluate the leftover one. And similarly we learned in the Braisa, a person should not tell his friend, Hareini imcha, that I'm with you, meaning I'm counted on this animal, besela, for a sela, and imcha b'shtayim, I'm with you for two slime, which again, this is like Shmuel who says, you know, I'll go ahead and set prices on yamtiv. Aval emel, what you could tell him is, Hareini imcha l'mechzel shoshabi, I'm with you for a half, a third, and a quarter, meaning you could say parts, but you can't talk about pricing, because pricing is forbidden, because mimtzeh chadis kabadabadabar, which is forbidden to be done on Shabbos and on yamtiv. Thank you to any time. 106.